Okay, so let us start the last day of this three-day conference. It's a great pleasure and honor to have Professor Pavel Etingof from MIT, who is going to talk about short-store products for filtered quantizations.
Okay, thank you very much. And I will, my product is short. Start. This is joint work. And it rings. That was Stryker. So Douglas Stryker is an MIT undergraduate who had a Europe undergraduate research project, and this grew out of that. So this is a study of non-commutative algebra, which is motivated by some quantum field theory. So let A be a commutative algebra over complex numbers, and it's going to be Z graded. So this means that I have a direct sum decomposition. A0 is going to be just one dimensional, just C, spanned by the union, and also homogeneous parts are finite dimensional. The plain example will be finitely generated algebras, which are algebras of regular functions on affine cones. So suppose that we have a Poisson bracket on A. Of degree minus 2. I should say that in applications, we could in general consider arbitrary homogeneous Poisson bracket of negative degree in this theory and generalize it with some small changes. But actually, in most applications, the degree of Poisson bracket is either minus 1 or minus 2. And if it is minus 1, we can just multiply all the degrees by 2 and make it minus 2. So this case covers most of the applications. And so let me make a definition. So since we have a degree minus 2 Poisson bracket, then we have an action on Z mod 2 by minus 1 to the degree. And this action preserves both the product, which has degree 0, and the bracket, which has degree minus 2. Definition is the following. Z mod 2 equivalent star product on A is a product of the following form. So A star B is equal to A times B, usual product, and then we deform it. H bar times, this is a Planck constant, C1 of AB plus H bar squared times C2 of AB plus so on. So this is what we do when we pass from classical mechanics to quantum mechanics. Classical mechanics happens on a phase space, which usually has a symplectic structure. So functions in this space have a Poisson bracket. And then when we quantize our theory, we turn functions into operators, and they no longer commute, and the product is deformed, and this is how it is deformed, that the parameter of deformation is h bar, which is the Planck constant, when we take the classical limit, this constant is supposed to go to zero, and we are only left with this first one. So what do we require for these things? So these have to be linear maps like this, and they should be of degree minus 2i. And also we want this to be associated. So this is really the main requirement. And Poisson bracket, and what, how is it related to Poisson bracket? This should be recovered from this C1. So we should have C1 of AB minus C1 of BA, which is really the limit when H goes to zero. AB minus BA over H1 should be equal to the Poisson bracket of AB. So this.
You assign degree 2 to H bar in all these constructions?
Yes. So the H bar has degree 2. But in fact, I'm going to set. So I'll set H bar to 1, and then it will become a filtered algebra rather than a graded algebra. So the star product turns A into filtered algebra. And I make a definition that this star product is even if Ci of AB is Q symmetric for odd I and symmetric for even I. So minus 1 to the I times Ci of B. In this case, Ci, this is just twice C1 of AB. So we will get that C1 of AB has to be equal to 1 half of the Poisson bracket of AB. So these definitions are completely classical, and there is an example, classical example, where, which is the main example, or the most basic example, maybe, which is the Moyal star product. And in this example, V is a symplectic vector space. So finite dimensional. We take the algebra of regular functions of this space, which is the symmetric algebra of the dual space. And then we we have a pi in wedge 2 of V, which is the Poisson bivector. And so this is the inverse of the symplectic form. And we define the star product in the following way. A star B is equal to the multiplication of E to the pi over 2 applied to A tensor with. So where what does it mean? So A tensor with B lies in this A tensor A. And then this is a bivector, so it's a biderivation of our algebra. So we can take e to the pi over 2 of that, which means if I take the power series of the exponential, and then I multiply components. And note that such infinite expressions, like here, for example, we have an infinite series. And even if we set, so if h bar is a formal variable, this certainly makes sense. But even if we set h bar to 1, we get just an ordinary series of elements in A cross A. But we don't need to worry about its convergence, because it is clear from this definition that if A is in A I and B is in AJ, then CK of AB is 0 if K is bigger than I plus J divided by 2. Just for degree reasons, because CK of AB would have negative degree. We don't have anything in negative. And similarly, this thing makes sense. And to make this more explicit, let me take E equals to C2. We have coordinates P and X, standard coordinates P and X. and they are canonical, so the Poisson bracket is 1. And then the formula looks like this. So write it explicitly, sum from n equals 0 to infinity, 1 over 2 to the n times n factorial, times dp tensor dx minus dx tensor dp to the n times a tensor b. And then we do multiplication. So if you like, this is going to be the following: AB plus 1/2 A derivative with respect to P, B derivative with respect to X minus AX plus So this is the standard example, and this is even.
And in the original definition of the CIs, what is the definition of CI? I mean, it's like this, right? I mean, it's just the power of, it can be written respect.
No. So this is a general definition of star, by a star product is a collection of CI satisfying these conditions. So it is associative and this. What we want is to learn to construct such star products, and in particular star products with a certain property that I'm going to say. This is a basic example. So here degree of all variables is 1, and the degree of this Poisson bracket is minus 2 variables. So now here is a, so this is very old. This is 100 years old and goes to back to basics of quantum mechanics. But now I will make a definition that is much more recent, and it is due to physicists Beam, Liers, and Rastelli, 2016. And the definition is the following. We say that the star product is short if CK of AB vanishes for A in AI, B in AJ, and K bigger than the minimum of I and J. So automatically, as I said, we have that this is true when K is bigger than I plus J over 2, but we will require a stronger condition that it is true in this case. By the way, I will always consider Zeeman two equivariant objects, and I will no longer specify them. So this is the definition. And this was motivated by a three-dimensional superconformal quantum field theory. There are some quantum algebras that appeared there which had this property.
I'm still confused. In the condition for C1, in the original definition, mm-hmm. the limit being the brackets, that almost defines C1. But is there such constraint for C2 so that I can see from there what should be C2?
No, there is no. There could be many different C2s. So C1 is only constrained to be this in the given case, but already starting from C2, you have some freedom, and it's not... So Kantsevich proved, for example, that if this algebra is regular, if it is algebra of functions in a smooth variety, then C2, C3, and so on always exist. But that's a very non-trivial theorem, and there are also many different... So this is the definition, and so this is called the truncation condition. Uh, And an example of this is that the Monial product is short. And this is pretty clear. So what happens if you have a polynomial of degree I, and this is a degree j, so when we get to the smaller of them, after that we will have higher order of derivative, and it will kill the polynomial of the smaller degree. So that's very easy to see. And another example, we could actually modify this example slightly and write A star B in this situation. So we are going to deform. So this is multiplication of exponential of 1 half dp dx minus dx dp a tensor b. But I can deform this and write that this is equal to multiplication of the exponential of the following thing, alpha dp dx minus 1 minus alpha dx dp a tensor b, where alpha is any number. And then this is always short. It's associative, always short, and even not even unless alpha equals to 1. Okay, so so what motivation for this study was the physical conjecture. So from the physics considerations, it followed that if you have a hyperkähler cone, which means a kind of singular hyperkähler manifold, then if you take function algebra, regular functions on this cone, then this algebra admits a short star product, and that they have a nice structure. They are parameterized by finitely many parameters, and they can be computed in a sense. And so this study was motivated by that. So let me give another background thing, which is another approach to this star product. So another way to parameterize star products, another way to talk about them. So this is a definition. So now we will define a filter quantization of A. And again, it will be Z mod 2 equivariant. With this Poisson bracket is a Z greater or equal to 0 filtered associated algebra. Let me call it script A. So this is going to be not a direct sum, but the union over I greater or equal to 0 f I k. And the associated graded of this A equals to A. And then we need to lift the Z mod 2 structure, so and a filtration preserving automorphism. Yes, A whose associated graded is this map minus 1 to the t that we considered before. And for example, any star product defines such quantization. So every star product defines the quantization, its filter quantization. Namely, this A is simply going to be the same space, but with a different multiplication, which is given by the star product. And the filtration induced by the gradient. So the point is that when we introduce these lower order terms, then this product is no longer homogeneous, and it doesn't preserve this direct sum decomposition, but only preserves the filtration that is induced by this decomposition. The question is, can we go the other way? Can we recover star product from this filtered quantization? And the answer is, no, not quite, because star product has much more information. So we need to add some information. And so the information is the following that we need to add. So we need to add a quantization map. This is something that in quantum mechanics called quantization map. So definition, a quantization map for a filter quantization is a splitting of the filtration. Phi from A to A. So this means that this preserves filtration and associated gradient of phi equals to the identity. So this is a linear splitting, of course, just a linear map. So we have for every A in this algebra A, we have phi of A, which in quantum mechanics books is denoted by A hat. So this is the operator which quantizes a classical observable A. And so in other words, we realize this non-commutative, so we define a quantization map. So to every classical observable, we attach its quantization. But then, of course, this cannot be a homomorphism of algebras. And if you translate the product in this A into a product on A, we will get something different than the classical product, but we will get its deformation. And that would be the star product. So in this case, A star phi is equal to phi inverse of phi of A times phi of And this way we can go back and forth. So if you have a star product, you get a quantization, and you get map phi, which is just the identity map, because these spaces are the same now. And conversely, if we have a filtered quantization with a quantization map, then this gives us a star product using this construction. So proposition, again, it's very basic and simple. There is a bijection, natural bijection between star products and filtered quantizations equipped with a quantization. And then you might ask, what happens to the evenness condition? So if we consider even star product, what does this correspond to in the language of quantization maps? And the answer is that even star products correspond to the following situation. So you need A plus phi, and we have sigma from A to A, which is an anti-automorphism preserving filtration such that the associated gradient, such that its square is the automorphism S, which defines the Z-mod 2 action, and associated gradient of sigma equals to minus 1, square root of minus 1 to the T. So this is the kind of structures that arise in this quantum field theory setting. So let me give you an example of another example of short and even star products. So let's take the algebra SN2 and take A, which is U high which is the quotient of this enveloping algebra of G by the relation that the Casimir element is equal to some eigenvalue chi. So in this case, the associated gradient of this algebra is the algebra of function on the nilpotent cone. So this is what is straight A. To define the star product, we need, so this is just quadratic cone. This is a C of x, y, z modulo the relation x, y equals to z squared. Usual quadratic cone. And I can decompose A with respect to the action of SN2. So A is the V0, which is one-dimensional representation, plus V2, which is the three-dimensional, plus V4, plus so on, as a representation of SL2. And this is actually the grading on the algebra. So this is A0, this is A1, this is A2, and so on. And we have a tensor product rule that if you take Vi and you tensor it with Vj, then there is a clear Schwartz rule, which means that we start with absolute value I minus j plus I minus j plus 2 plus so on. And what this means that if you define a quantization. So first of all, so what we can see from this, this is a multiplicity-free decomposition, and therefore we have a unique quantization map, which is SL2 invariant. So we see that there exists a unique phi, which is essentially invariant. And it defines a short and even star. So in this case, the grading is, actually I should say that this is A2 and this is A4. Because in this case, the Poisson bracket has degree minus 1, naturally, which is the Kirillov Poisson-Suryo bracket. But I will multiply degrees by 2, so the degrees will be even. So this star product is short for representation theoretic reasons. Because when we tensor Vi with Vj, we do not get any lower contributions than Vi minus j. So this means that I cannot get to degree lower than Vi minus j. And it is even, again, for representation theoretic reasons, because if you consider the map from Vi tensored if you look at these maps from Vi tensor Vj to Vi, I plus j, defined by this star product, then these maps will be symmetric if degree is I is odd and skew symmetric. Sorry, degree I is even and skew symmetric. So actually, representation theory here controls everything. And actually, this example is very suggestive. So the way that it happens in this physics theory is very similar. So the point is that for hyperkähler cone, so you know that if you have a hyperkähler manifold, then it has a CP1 of complex structures. In general, these complex structures are not isomorphic to each other. But if you have a hyperkähler cone, then these are all isomorphic to each other. And in fact, there is an action of SU2, which preserves, which interchanges them and acts transitively on CP1. And this SU2, therefore, will act, it acts not holomorphically, but it acts on the space of real C infinity functions. And this phenomenon of shortness really comes from representation theory of SU2 and from this thing here.
What about the Nyquan-Kwan and other algebras?
Yes, I will get to that. But now I want to give another kind of simple example, which is minimal orbit for another algebra. So in this case, so X in so this is a simple algebra, and there is always a unique important orbit of minimal dimension, which is not trivial, and we can look at its string of functions and redecompose it as a G module. And then it looks like this. V of 0 plus V with highest plane theta, which is the adjoint representation. This is the maximal root, so this is just G. Then V 2 theta, V 3 theta, and so on. And then we again have the same thing for the same reason. There exists a unique quantization map, which is V invariant. The unique G invariant quantization. Maybe I should say that there is a quantization. There is a unique quantization in the types other than type A. And one parameter family for type A. And for each of these quantization, for each of them, there exists a unique quantization of G invariant quantization map. Which gives rise to a short and even start. So so this is well known that these quantizations exist, and I should say that the previous example is a special case of this OSL2. We have a one-parameter family of quantizations, which are those algebras U prime, and we get this short even circle. So this is what was written. Nothing new so far. So all of this was written in this paper by Bean, Elias, and Rastelli. So these are the cases when it is easy to see that there are short and even spare products. But in general, it is not obvious why they exist. For example, if we take another Lie algebra and instead of this orbit, we take the fully important component, then it's not completely clear. Then there are many G-invariant star products. And there are also other representations that occur. Here we also have this Clebsch-Gordan property that if you have V k theta occurs in Vi theta tensor to Vj theta, then k is greater than or equal than absolute value of I minus g. But in general, we will have other representations entering, and it is not clear at all why you will have such a quantization. If you just take a random quantization, for example, if you take, Campbell-Hausdorff quantization for an important quantum, it is not going to satisfy this property. So there was a conjecture, nevertheless, of this physicist, which said the following. So let X be a hyper-Taylor quantum. I'm not going to give a precise definition of this. So this is a kind of singular hyper-Taylor manifold, which basically is a holomorphic symplectic with singularities, and on the open part you have a hyper-Taylor metric, and it behaves nicely on the boundary. There are many examples of this. Let me just tell you examples.
Can I ask you, in the previous example, why is it short?
Exactly for the same reason, that if this representation occurs in this tensor product, then k is at least I plus minus j.
You said there is unique. So are you saying that in type A there is one dramatic family, but only one of them is short?
No, it is short for all. There is a, for each of this family, for each quantization, there is a unique short star product. There is a unique gene variant quantization map. And this is obvious because we have a multiplicity free decomposition.
Sure.
And this map gives rise to a short and even star product.
I see.
So any quantization admits a presentation using such star product. Did I answer your question? Yeah, so the conjecture is the form. So we take hyperkähler form. So this is, I mean, it's not that easy to define, but there are some examples. So the main examples are the Higgs branch or Coulomb branch for three-dimensional superconformal field theory. And mathematically, for example, what is Higgs branch? It's a Hamiltonian reduction of an action of hyperkähler reduction of an action of a compact Lie group by symplectic transformation on a quaternionic representation. So if you have a quaternionic space with an action of a compact Lie group, you can define a hyperkähler quotient. And this quotient admits an action of SU2, which is part of the quaternion algebra. And this is going to be a hyperkähler.
And this is just for you, the Higgs branch, right?
Yes. But also there are other examples, such as closures of nilpotent orbits, quotient singularities, so symplectic vector space quotient by a finite group of symplectic transformations, and so on, which is really a special case of what I said before, except that the group is finite. Then you do not have to do any reduction, you just take an ordinary quotient.
So all quiver varieties,
yes, they're all reductions, so they will be like that. And also Coulomb branches, which are cones, are also like that.
Again, so is this as a complex variety like symplectic singularities?
Yes. So this will be a variety. The complex structure I is going to build algebraic variety structure on this thing. You just take functions that are homogeneous with respect to the action of the torus of the SU2 group, and it has a resolution of singularities where symplectic form lifts where generic symplectic form on generic locus lifts to a regular two form, not necessarily non-degenerate on the resolution. So for algebraic geometries, this is symplectic singularities. But not arbitrary symplectic singularities. Symplectic singularities say that admit hyperkähler structure. The conjecture says that, so if you take algebra of functions on X, which is graded by the action of this U1 group, preserving complex structure I, then there are two parts. So first of all, short even star products exist on every even quantization. They conjectured on every quantization, but maybe I should say generic quantization, because there could be some singularities in generic even quantization. So quantizations depend on some parameters, and for generic value of parameters. And even quantization means that you have this automorphism, anti-automorphism sigma, such that this is satisfied. And the second conjecture is, and they are parameterized by finitely many parameters. And so what I want to report is that we were able to prove this at least partially. So here is a theorem. part two to the conjecture. Yes, and part one of the conjecture existence, this results are not as complete, but it says yes as, in many cases. And this is still work in progress, so I got some very useful feedback from David de Gaiota, who explained to me how to do even more cases, maybe the general Higgs bridge case, and so on. So,
suppose we don't have shortness conditions. Suppose we don't require this shortness condition still to the quantization. We won't have this kind of finite many parameters?
No, of course not. Quantizations are parameterized by finitely many parameters. But star products are not, because star products are parameterized by this quantization map. So this is an arbitrary linear map between infinite dimensional spaces which preserves filtration. And it's a graded part of the identity. So this means it's an upper triangular matrix of infinite size with ones on the diagonal. But there are still many, infinitely many entries that are arbitrary. So this heavily constrains the star product, and then you get finitely many parametric family, which you can actually compute. I mean, I should say that all of those star products define the same quantization. They define the same algebra. But star product is an additional structure, is a choice of some additional structure in the algebra. And these structures, there are infinitely many of them, and this is kind of garbage. But if you require this this condition, you get some beautiful structure.
So could you tell us what the families are?
Okay. Yes, I will say, yes. Okay. So, but first of all, let me explain the approach to this problem, which was suggested to me by Kansevich, and which really clarifies the situation a lot. Because it is not clear how, I mean, there is some physics construction, but mathematically it wasn't clear for me how to construct these star problems. But Kansevich explained to me the following. Let psi, so we have some quantization, and let psi from A to A be a linear filtration preserving. I do not require it to be a homomorphism or anything. And let me make the following definition. A psi twisted trace on A is a linear function of T from A to C such that the T of alpha beta equals to T of psi of beta times one. So if we did not have a psi, then this would be the usual property of trace. So this is why it's called psi twisted. And also the trace, so this is this defines a bilinear form. So this is B sub T of alpha beta. And T is non-degenerate if this form Bt is not just non-degenerate, but this is important, is non-degenerate when restricted on every filtration piece. So that's a stronger condition. So it's non-degenerate on every filtration piece. And then there is a lemma. Which is kind of surprising when you first see it, but it's easy to prove. And it says that if T is non-degenerate, is a non-degenerate psi twisted trace, then psi is an automorphism of algebras, first of all. So that's pretty surprising, but it's true. So you see, the point is you may not believe it at first sight. But actually what happens is, if you have such T, then this psi actually can be recovered uniquely on every fi, just from this identity. But if you just take a random t, of course, if you take a randomly chosen t, it will be non-degenerate on all the fi, if there exists a t which is non-degenerate. There are, of course, infinite-dimensional space of such t, so it's a kind of garbage. But what will happen is you will define psi on each fi, but they won't agree when you restrict from fi plus 1 to fi. If they agree, that's a very strong condition on t, and it actually leads to psi being restricted to be a homomorphism. Jerome, you have a question?
Psi and t will be defined on fi.
Yeah. So if I have a t which is a linear function on A, let's say randomly chosen, usually this condition will be satisfied. This condition that it's non-degenerate on every fi. And then we can define psi I, which is a map from fi to fi, which satisfies this equation. But psi I will not in general be equal to psi I plus 1 restricted to fi.
So psi I will not preserve fi minus 1.
Yeah. So this psi will not be filtration preserving.
It's clear that if it preserves,
yes,
then it has to be equal, but it doesn't preserve.
That's right, yes. It won't preserve fi. Psi I plus 1 will not preserve fi in general. If it does, this is a very strong condition which forces this to be an automorphism. And another lemma which was explained to me by Kantsevich is that if so, then the corresponding... Then you can define some if t is non-degenerate, then we can define ai, which is f I minus 1 of a curve. So this is a subspace in the filtration piece f I, which is a complement to filtration piece I minus 1. With respect to the form, and AI identifies with this AI, which is just the quotient of FI of A by FI minus 1 of A. So we get a canonical quantization map. So this identification will be called phi I, and we get a canonical quantization map. Phi, which is the direct sum of all phi. And another lemma, also explained to me by Kantsevich, is that the star product corresponding to phi is short. So this is actually very easy to show. And actually we can also go back. So if star is short, if star is any star product, first of all, we always have a linear function on T, which is just the zero mode. So t from the commutative algebra A to C, we always have t of A is just the zero mode, degree zero part. And then if star is a star product on A, then we have a bilinear form of A and B is t of the star product, A star.
Actually, I'm sorry, I still don't understand. Maybe it looks to me like you described a structure which is weaker than what's written. So what is this map which is So you're considering a situation when psi is defined on fi, but they don't agree when you restrict it?
No. I consider the situation when when t is non-degenerate psi twisted traits. So this means psi, by definition, agrees with the filtration.
Yes. And then what again?
And then psi is an automorphism, first of all.
Yeah.
And then I can also do the following. So I can take this subspace inside fi, and I have this bilinear form. And this form, this is a non-degenerate subspace for this bilinear form. So I can take its orthogonal complement inside this Fi. And this would be a complement to this. And then I can, so this gives me a splitting of the filtration.
I understand, but you were discussing a few minutes ago some map which is defined on each Fi, but...
Right, so I was trying to explain why this lemma is not obviously false. So it is hard to believe that some non-degeneracy condition can force something to be an automorphism. But it happens because this actually, so if I just take a random T, what will happen is that this psi will exist at every degree, but they won't agree to go from one degree to the other.
Why is Fi modulo Fi minus 1 the bound AR?
By definition, because recall that this straight A is an associated gradient of this script A. So we have this bilinear form, and then we say that star is non-definition, that star is non-degenerate if this form is non-degenerate. So if star is short, so maybe I should say that if star is short, then this form, the graded pieces are orthogonal. So if star is short, AI is orthogonal to AJ for I different from J. And the short star product is full non-degenerate if this form is non-degenerate. Non-degenerate on each AI, but it is the same in this case because it is graded to be non-degenerate on the whole space. And in this case, we do recover this twisted trace. We have Ci of A star B equals to Ci of psi of B. So the psi is determined by if A and B are in AI, and this is just in C, this is an A zero. So there is a bijection again. So we have a bijection. So non-degenerate psi twisted traces for some automorphism. And short non-degenerate star products. And there is also, I can say what the evenness condition is. So if you require evenness here, then the evenness condition means here that T is sigma stable, where sigma is the anti-automorphism of order 4, and psi equals S, where S is the sigma 2 action. Okay, so this is very useful because these traces are much easier to understand. They, in fact, have to do with Hochschild homology. So let me explain what happens now. So here is a proof of part 2 of the conjecture. So why these things are parametrized by finitely many parameters. And so the proof is goes as follows. So we see that So we need to show that these short star products are parametrized by finitely many parameters. So what data do we need to fix? So first of all, we need to fix a psi from A to A. But this A, gradient of A is this A, which is functions on my cone, which is an algebraic variety. So this is finitely generated. And this means that this is also finitely generated. So any automorphism of algebras is determined by its action on some low degrees. So this means that the psi lies in G, which is actually an algebraic group. And in fact, it's a reductive group. This is how hyperkähler cones are special among general symplectic singularities. So for general symplectic singularities, this may fail to be a reductive group. But for hyperkähler cone, it is forced to be reductive because its real part preserves hyperkähler metric and therefore is compact. And then if we fix this phi, then this trace, well, it satisfies this condition. So this means that it is an element of the dual space of the Hochschild zeros homology of this algebra A with coefficients in H psi. And also it has to be invariant with respect to this S automorphism. And with all we need, so if we fix this psi, then first of all, we have to fix a quantization. Maybe I should mention how quantizations are parameterized. Quantizations of A are parameterized by, so this was done by Losev, by a certain space H, finite dimensional space, modulo W, which is called Namikawa value. So this Namikawa Y group is a certain reflection group acting on this H. And this H is a second cohomology of some partial resolution, which is called the Q factorial terminalization of X. So it's a finite dimensional space that can be explicitly described. And so the data we need is some lambda quantization parameter in here, and some psi, which is an element of this algebraic group. And then, given that, the parameter is T, which is this trace. And so all we need to show that the space H0 of A psi star S is finite dimension. And so how to show this? So let me consider an example when psi equals to 1. So in this example, the proposition is that H0 of A is finite dimensional. And the proof is the following, that recall that we have hyperkähler cone. Therefore, it's a symplectic singularity. So X is a symplectic singularity. And therefore, by Kalenin's theorem, it has finitely many symplectic leaves. So this H0 of A is the quotient of A by the commutator. So if you take the associated gradient of this H0, this is a quotient of Poisson zeros homology of the classical algebra, where this is just the quotient of A by the Poisson gradient of A with A. And then there is a theorem, which we proved with Stryker-Schindler, which says that if X is a variety which has finitely many symplectic leaves, Poisson variety was skin given with finally many simplex eclipses, then C of x over C of x, C of x is finite dimension. The theorem is proved using the theory of D-modules, namely, to every such x, we attach a certain D-module on x, and if x has finitely many simplex eclipses, then it turns out to be holonomic, and its singular support is the union of conormal bundles of the simplex eclipses. Since it's a singular space, you need to embed it to a smooth space, and then what I say starts to make sense. And this D-module turns out to be holonomic, and then the space turns out to be middle cohomology, so it's finite dimension. And so this proves finite dimensionality in this example. And then if psi is not equal to 1, then you have to generalize slightly. So let me just, that will be the last thing I'll explain. So if psi not equal to 1, but finite order, then can consider the fixed points and apply the same argument to the fixed points, and that also proves finite dimensionality. And in general, you can also use this argument in using the fact that this is a reductive group. You can prove it for any psi. Yeah, so I'm going to the last thing I will say, the existence part. So which classes, I was asked, which classes I can show that this thing exists. So I can show short star product exists in the following examples. So the quotient singularity is V mod G, where G is finite, and V is symplectic vector space for every quantization parameter. Then midpotent cone of Lie algebra. And some quiver varieties, maybe all. This is still work in progress. There are two methods of doing this that I know so far. Deformation theoretic, when you start with some non-degenerate, because you have to construct a trace that is non-degenerate. So if you already know that one trace is non-degenerate, you can get it by deformation argument. And also unitarity, so you can show that you make this fourth Hermitian and show that it is positive definite, and then deduce non-degeneracy from there. And this technique I used in the nilpotent form. Okay, thank you very much.
Any questions?
Yeah. Is there an analog of a Poisson's net secant type index for this trace or for this quantized algebra in this example?
Actually, probably there is. I haven't thought about it. Yeah.
What was the question?
That would be.
What was it? Can you repeat the question?
For Fedosov Nest Sagan index formula. There should be these traces related to quotient homology, so there should be some theory of this sort, but I haven't thought about this. This is all kind of very recent. Yes?
So for the minimal orbit, you said that there is a unique quantization data for each actual quantization, deformation, and so this says that there is a canonical automorphism. Trace in particular?
No, canonical automorphism is just the identity.
Ah.
And the trace, there is just one trace because this homology is, Poisson homology is obvious, it's obvious that it is one dimensional because this is just co-invariance of G in functions. And so this trace is, in this case, obvious.
So in this side with the trace case, I got lost here. What is does it define the CIs or does it just?
Yes, it does. Yeah, it defines the CIs. It defines the whole star product, A star B.
So what is the CI?
Yeah, so if you have a trace, then you get a quantization map, phi from A to A. And then A star B is going to be phi inverse of phi of A times phi of B. And there are also methods of constructing traces using representations here. Actually, if you have a torus action with finitely many fixed points on symplectic resolution, then you have category O as in Braid and Proudfoot and Webster. And any module in this category defines you such a trace twisted by a torus element. Namely, you can take the trace of an algebra element times the torus element in this representation. Even if it's infinite dimensional, this makes sense as a series and gives you a rational function. And you can evaluate this function on an open set on the torus. This gives you a trace. And they are non-degenerate, and they give you everything in that case, basically.
So I'm building, probably these results, you start with a automorphism, and then you can classify the traces, but then figuring out if the traces are non-degenerate is a subtle question.
Yeah, because it's the condition that it has to be non-degenerate when restricted to fi is a subtle question, and actually is somewhat unnatural from the representation theoretic point of view. So, for example, if you look at the set of, if you take the determinant of this trace on fi, and view it as a function of the parameters, then it will not factor into linear polynomial, but will be some kind of crazy polynomial. Mm. But it's not completely crazy. It's not a garbage. It's related to Pendeves fix and things like that.
So this is the most delicate part.
Right. So the point, what physicists explained to this structure was not known to representation theorists. And the reason it was not known is representation theorists always consider actions which are holomorphic because they're interested in algebraic geometry, action of the algebraic group by algebraic transformations of the algebra. But here we have an SU2 that acts real analytically. And this structure for hypercalor cones has not somehow been taken into account in the works of representation. And I think this opens a new direction in representation theory. So.
Okay, so let's thank Pavel again. Next talk is at 10:30.